So I have a nice long talk for you, and I thought maybe before a nice long talk gets started, it might be good to hear a song that I'm referring to, for those of you who might not know this song. So I have my sons, three rascally sons who are here, one with a guitar, and we want to sing a song, this song, for you first. There we go, Greg and Joe and Ben.
Okay, hi everyone. Hi friends. I'm Adin Ballou. So this is kind of an homage, I guess, to life in New England, etc. And the dad asked me to play this song.
We'll sing along. You know.
I don't know the song. I'm just going to hum. It's James Taylor.
Thank you.
there's a little explanation about that song because it's a Massachusetts cowboy song. And it's said that James Taylor was hanging out with Arlo Guthrie in the Berkshires, and when they wrote that together, or they were mutually inspired to come up with that Massachusetts cowboy song. And it's part of the lecture, so I thought, for those of you who didn't know about this, this would be important here. So thank you, guys. That was good. So thank you, everybody. This is the lecture for 2013, the Adin Ballou lecture, and it's entitled Hoping Still, Carrying Adin Ballou's Peace Torch into the 21st Century. I have a few quotes to open up from scripture and then another quote. How terrible it would be for me if I had not preached the gospel, from 1 Corinthians 9:16. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I by my works will show you my faith, James 2:18. True justice is the harvest reaped by peacemakers, from seed sown in the spirit of peace, James 3:18. Love delayed is not love denied, from the side of a celestial seasonings tea box. And there's a lot of good connections here to be made. So dear friends of Adin Ballou, and friends of the friends of Adin Ballou, and friends of the friends of the friends of Adin Ballou, this is a great day to be together. Isn't it such a beautiful day, such a wondrous day today in Hopedale? The beauty of fall in New England knows few parallels. The way the sun falls on the changing and lit up leaves brighten up our days in this annual riot of color that yet engenders thoughts of peace and plenty, of calm before the bare trees of winter tell another tale of storms, of winds and snows. It is an altogether wondrous time and celebration, a time of giftedness, this time of the harvest, of plenitude, of thanksgiving. And it seems most fitting that at this lecture, it should be scheduled in this season every year. This is the right time for the Adin Ballou lecture. I always liked Arlo Guthrie's lovely song, Massachusetts, in which he sings so tenderly and appreciatively of this region, despite his overuse of the word ain't, which makes him sound like he isn't from Massachusetts. I have friends who are librarians and editors and English teachers for whom this misuse of the language endlessly annoys and irritates. Some of them had the likes of Arlo in class and have had enough. I am not totally unsympathetic to their cause of grammatical correctness and compositional aptitude, yet I remain very partial to the colloquial and folk cultures, and even share that more primitive upbringing where to say ain't so bad. Especially if you can co-write a cowboy song about traveling from the Berkshires to Boston on a snowy day, the first day of December, and still have 10,000 miles to go. It is this combination of imagination and love that gives us reason to tell and sing our stories, and to be here in Hopedale with all of you on such a lovely fall Sunday afternoon in October, in this very heart of Massachusetts, brings Arlo's grateful disposition to mind and heart. He sings, "You can tell me about the times you spent on the Rockies and on the plains. Please don't think that I'm the last to say there ain't lots of other places in this world that still remain beautiful and unchanged, but they're not just the same. The sun comes up to meet the dawn, and there's a day that must go on. There's another night that's gone in Massachusetts. And I could spend all of my days and remain each day amazed at the way each day is phrased in Massachusetts. Now, if you could only see, I know you would agree, there ain't nowhere else to be like Massachusetts. And there's a house upon the hill that keeps us from the chill, and by the grace of God, we will be in Massachusetts. Come on, tell me about the time you spent in the Rockies and on the plains, and please don't think that I'm the last to say that there ain't lots of other places in this world that still remain beautiful and unchanged, but they're just not the same as Massachusetts." I echo Arlo's sentiments on this day, when as I look around and see so many friends and people here who have cared for me and for each other in these parts at one time or another. I cannot help but feeling a lot like Arlo, tender and appreciative, here in Massachusetts, even as I have spent time in the Rockies and on the plains and in the foothills of the Sierra Nevadas, for that matter, with old friends. Nettie Lou Lane, Nettie is here in the front row, and Johnny Souza. We crossed the very high peaks of the Rockies all alone as the Pilgrim Three. One winter day, I believe in January of 1984, in Johnny's old yellow submarine step van, replete with fishing poles and wash tubs tied to its sides, with all kinds of spindly strings and ropes, as a freshly fallen snow blanketed us with a serenity and purity and promise that were absolutely breathtaking. Remember that day, Nettie Lou? It was a beautiful, beautiful moment to be captured in memory for all time, it would seem. A moment that will forever be cherished. But it's still not the same as Massachusetts. Or is it not? Oh. As I look out at this gathering in this valley, this little dale at the foot of its neighboring hills, and see so many of you who have been my friends, mentors, guides, colleagues, critics, students, or members of this or that ragtag assorted band of nondescript pals, all I can say is that today in Massachusetts, you are all making this day, as Arlo might say, beautifuler. Thanks to all of you so much for being here. I wish, before I really get on my soapbox in earnest, to express my sincerest gratitude to those who shared a bit of my background with the Friends of Adin Ballou in hopes of making a connection. Thank you, Ann Briggs. Ann is here. And thanks in abundance to those of you who asked me, Bill DeLuca, and the other key friends of the Friends of Adin Ballou, who in one fortuitous evening meeting asked me to speak to you today. It means a lot to this rascal, believe it or not, a real lot. I am also obliquely, or better, mystically aware of Gene Kinney's, Nancy Naroyan DeLuca's, Reverend Dan Charette's, Bernie Gilgun's, Jim Connolly's, John J. O'Brien, Rita Corbin's, Tom Lewis's, Stanley Vishnewski's, Chuck Matthai's, Dorothy Day's, and the Paulsons and Roaches of the Upton Catholic Worker Farm for their influence from above in these matters. There truly is a cloud of witnesses who surround us with their love and perennial invitation to be as good as we can be with their help. I had met Gene Kinney a few times and had just begun an exchange about the likely perspectives we shared when she unexpectedly passed. And Viola is here, and we met at Clark, the Center for Nonviolent Solutions gathering, and Gene and we were going to try to plan to get together. I sense already kinship beyond the temporal and spatial at work in relation to both Adin and Gene and the other wondrous mentors and guides aforementioned, who share the quest for a more just and peaceful world. Those who have gone before us deserve so much due. We stand on the shoulders of our wise and saintly elders, and we rightfully wish to pass the fruits of their great legacies on to our young. Speaking of the young, my three sons, there was a TV show by that name, Ben from the north and Joe and Greg from the south, meaning they came from New Hampshire and New York City. Buggies. Thanks for being here, guys. And thanks again to all of you for being here from whatever direction you came. Very special thanks also to Rosalie Regal, who is here from Chicago and so generously came this way on this leg of her book tour to participate in the roundtable following this lecture. She has us listening to the voices of many war resistors she interviewed these last years. And thanks also to Suzanne Belote and Brayton Shanley from the Agape community in Hardwick, who also speak at the roundtable from the vantage of their 30-plus years experiment in Christian living, who our mutual friend and gifted author Mike True described in his portrait of Adin Ballou in his book Constructing Peace. In communities of education and action, at least, Adin Ballou's spirit is very much alive, wrote Mike. Agape community in Ware, Massachusetts, resembles, in fact, Ballou's Hopedale community, a 19th century utopian experiment in nearby Milford. For both, the nonviolent gospel involving a refusal to kill and a commitment to social justice is central. We will hear from these good sisters and brother. They long and tirelessly at work for peace at the round table following a break after this talk. You'll be grateful for that break, I'm sure. We're still at the beginning, oh my. My old mustard seed Catholic worker companions and the Annunciation folks' house are here and share a big part of the story I could tell if I had all day and all night. And I am, in the words of my wife Diane, she's in the front row too, quote, one who has been enchanted by the serendipitous attempt of the Catholic worker to bring order to a disordered world, to bring justice to an existence that is merely justified. She really said that. I am a believer in the communion of saints, that great cloud of precedent witnesses to whom we still look for inspiration and for intercession. Father Bernie Gilgun, my and many of my dearest friends' particular mentor, was a celebrated preacher, Worcester's civil rights and anti-war priest. He was also the sidekick of Abby Hoffman, the Yippie leader, who called Bernie, quote, in his autobiography, soon to be a major motion picture, the best movement orator outside of Malcolm X, maybe even better, because he spoke right from the heart. Bernie used to call us again and again in his regular homilies to, quote, have life with the living God and the joyful communion of the saints. And that surely included life with those who went before us, as it did life with each other here and now on the so-called earthly plane. He oft repeated the signal question of one of the great poets of lament in and for the 20th century, and whose cry remains very pertinent for ours. T.S. Eliot asked, what life have you if you have not life together? It's the big question of the day. We are surely blessed to be gathered in this hallowed place named Hopedale, where people asked and took up that question long before Eliot asked it. The people who founded Hopedale did so in their estimate of that very virtue, the virtue of hope, in hopes that they could have life together and mirror a community of persons committed to equality and peace that could be a model for the whole world to see and imitate. Some would say that Hopedale was one of the more successful of the communal ventures begun by the utopian visionaries in the mid-19th century. Many of the experiences were very short-lived, but not so Hopedale, where members wanted to be a trailblazing model of a better world, a fairer world, and thus a more peaceful world, that they could bespeak a more promising future for all the peoples of the world. Such a world is what they sought. They believed steadfastly in that ideal and worked very hard for it, and they kept at it for 14 to 15 years. They were led by the man who is at the heart of our celebration today and whose statue stands across the way. We visited it, some of us from out of town, before we came here for the service, a beautiful statue of Adin. Away from this church, which still shelters and nurtures his spiritual progeny. Who was and is this Adin Ballou who we honor today? To answer that question adequately would perhaps take several Ballou lectures, but there is much that can be gained by way of sharing a profile or sketch that can be telling and helpful, especially to those less familiar with him. Adin Ballou was born in 1803 on a farm in Cumberland, Rhode Island, and he died here in Hopedale in 1890. He worked the family farm as a boy and, quote, got religion, as they say, in a family with serious faith commitments, they having their very own Ballou meeting house. And it was discovered in that house of worship one day that young Adin had an extraordinary gift to preach. He also had a great thirst for knowledge and became an autodidact as to quench that thirst as best he could in the light of his family's financial inability to afford him a higher education that he really would have liked to have. But even without formal theological studies, Adin began preaching, moved by what he felt was God's call to him. And he was a rather immediate homiletic sensation. But there was more going on in young Adin's life. There was an unusual mystical thread that ran through his ministerial life. And the young man grew to minister in various places, to various folks, in various ways, involved as he was in a number of theological controversies of the day. He made many changes in his own theological outlook and understanding of what the gospel meant and where the gospel was leading. But underneath them all was this haunting call, heard early on in a dream of God speaking to him through the words of his older brother Cyrus, who had died, that he'd best preach the gospel or be liable for the fate of salvation-needy souls in need of hearing the good news he could and must now share. Eventually, Adin forsook doctrinal disputation, which he was, by the way, very good at, by trying to live the way Jesus would have his disciples live. And he embraced the spirit and temper of the social reform movements that swept through the nation mid-century. The social gospel, temperance, abolitionism, women's rights, communalism, pacifism. Adin lived and wrote, in effect, a theology and philosophy of Christian peacemaking. And Leo Tolstoy, the world's greatest writer at the time, had gotten hold of some of the writing that Adin had done. And he designated Adin Ballou as the world's greatest writer. Now, I've read some of Adin Ballou, and this is my assessment, my modest assessment. My sense is that it was not Adin's style of writing mm-hmm. that brought him such high praise from Tolstoy, although it's not bad writing, so much as the content of his writing. Adin's literature was about the most important subject of all to Tolstoy and to all humankind, love. It was this look and his take on redemptive love that so interested and impressed the great Russian writer, Tolstoy, who now, with a long Adin, is a notable champion of Christian pacifism and anarchism. There's a poster here at the bottom of that we brought that is very telling with regard to a couple of statements I'm going to make next. And Adin is at the top there. There's a little picture of Adin at the top. Mohandas K. Gandhi, a young lawyer in South Africa, bearing the brunt of racial discrimination there, picked up the writings of the Ballou-influenced Tolstoy and will lead a vast, impressive, and successful non-violent campaign to free India from the shackles of British colonialism. A young minister here, Martin Luther King Jr., also suffering and bearing the injuries of racial segregation and discrimination, picked up the writings of Gandhi to inspire and inform his own Christian nonviolent campaign to put an end to the politics of Jim Crow in the United States. Dorothy Day, whose picture is also here, a young radical journalist who became a Catholic convert in the late 1920s, embraced and promoted a principled Christian pacifism in her Catholic worker movement, and did this from 1933 until her death in 1980. She held to pacifism in difficult times, as did Adin Ballou in his, and she admired Martin Luther King Jr. Day is now being considered for sainthood in the Catholic Church, despite her fear of being put on a pedestal for the wrong reasons. "Don't call me a saint," she said. "Don't dismiss me that easily." Sanctity, in her book, was meant for us all. And she did not want to be seen as special or exceptional. She didn't want to let others off the hook with regard to the pursuit of sanctity for themselves. An amazing circle of observable Pacific influence has traversed the globe that had its start right here with Adin and his dream to establish a community based on what he called practical Christian socialism. It was a grand vision of economic and social justice and peace that Adin entertained and tried mightily to sustain because he got Jesus right. The renowned biblical scholar from the University of Notre Dame, Father John L. McKenzie, concludes, quote, "If we cannot know from the New Testament that Christ totally rejects violence, then we can know nothing of his person or message. It is the clearest of teachings. Adin had got hold of that clarity pre-Mackenzie and based his life and his work on it. Later, such moral clarity would find expression in what Mahatma Gandhi called Satyagraha, truth force, or what Martin Luther King Jr. called soul force, in the face of physical force. It is faith in the power of love as a power at once stronger and greater than the love for power, because infinitely more humble, unselfish, and inexhaustible. Of course, this way is the way of radical patience. It is not an easy way. It is the cross rather than the sword, but it is the truly efficacious way in the long run for establishing genuine peace in the world. Adin's family life was marked by great joys, but also sadness. And before some of us came here, we went to the cemetery where Adin's family is, Adin and his family are buried. And his family life was tough. His first wife, Abigail Sales, died shortly after giving birth, and several of Adin's later children predeceased him as well because of illnesses that took them all too soon. A daughter, Abby, survived into adulthood, and his second wife, Lucy Hunt, played a leadership role with him in the life of this Hopedale community. One remarkable feature, and telling feature at that, of Adin's life was his great fidelity and constancy in the face of so many personal and social challenges and tragedies. It seemed obstacles were no ultimate obstacle to him, though he was quite human and a human sufferer at that. No obstacle in the light of his faith that shaped his mostly undaunted spirit. It might also be of some interest to some of you to know how much this speaker identifies with Adin. I grew up in Linwood, just over those hills on the other side of the Blackstone River. Came from a family of modest means and was raised up a devout Catholic at Good Shepherd School and church. I did have an experience akin to Adin's one evening at the North Uxbridge Baptist Church. I got religion too. My mother got me reading early, and a dear nun teacher encouraged me to read well as well, and further to go to seminary to consider a possible vocation to the priesthood, which I did. The La Salette Prep Seminary was located in Enfield, New Hampshire, at the site of an old Shaker village, so I became somewhat of a Shackalick. When at that school, I lived a kind of semi-monastic life in the foothills of the White Mountains, and this when the Vietnam War was raging. All my background and some new influences, including those of a priest historian of the Shakers and a Quaker history teacher there, a fellow student who declared that as a Christian he would not kill, who is a Franciscan priest today, an alumnus who wrote to me about anti-draft work he was doing in Philadelphia, as well as the influence of a beautiful farmer's daughter who lived across the lake, all tended to reorient me more in the direction of being a Catholic hippie rather than a Catholic priest. And if you were Catholic and a hippie too, where would you go? The Catholic Worker was the place for you. I've been in this movement that cares for the poor, resists war, and builds sustainability and healthy living on farm communes ever since. But I've also been on the edges of professional life as well as in various employees, some in the Catholic Church, some outside. I am currently working as a part-time chaplain at Worcester Psychiatric Hospital, which I learned the planners of Hopedale visited in preparation for their founding. I imagine to see for their own edification and benefit aspects of communal living being lived out in a serious manner that they could appropriate in one form or another. There is interest there today at the hospital where I work in creating a more nonviolent institution. As you can imagine, there are a lot of challenges there. And I've been invited to consider speaking there about nonviolence from the perspective of Adin Ballou. So we might carry this banner down the road a little bit. A grace blending of many influences has been my lot. I must admit I've had both a lot of tragedy and suffering and a lot of joy in my life too. So I am Adin-like in many respects. and I have an abiding interest in nurturing nonviolent Christian community as Adin did. My friend Brayton here thinks that I should write books in my old age because I do have so many stories to tell about our own attempts at Christian peacemaking. I too, like Adin, envisioned a generous community of believers who would bring the values of heaven to earth and give it a pretty good try despite many struggles. Writing in retrospect about the years spent trying to do just that would also make me more Adin-like. But Brayton has just written one such book in his young, older years. But more about that at the round table. Some of his books are there, as well as Rosalie's. I also wanted, in these regards, to make mention of my own Irish blood forebears. And if any of you folks of Hopedale really know the town history, I could really use some help on this one. The Fahies, or Fahies, tied to the Boover, Beauvais family, it looks like it was Beauvais from, and Americanized at one point, settled in Milford, and Boover's of French Canadian descent, lived in Mendon, Milford, and Hopedale, living on Freedom Street for many years. My Boover ancestors are recorded as having being in Hopedale at the time of the 1900 census, only a decade after the Adin Ballou's death. I learned that the family came originally to Rhode Island from Quebec and then here. I wonder if any of them may have met Adin Ballou before moving here, who have been influenced by him along the way to do so. I imagine living in Hopedale, one is subject by a kind of moral osmosis, almost like catching the flu. In this case, a good contagion to necessarily being influenced by the effects and fruits of the seeds of peace that were planted here in the early 1840s. When the Boovers arrived in Hopedale, it seems, and it seems likely, that the Christian utopia of Adin had been de facto set aside in economic matters as the immigrant workforce was more warmly welcomed to join the burgeoning industrial movement that took its place once the original vision of a Christian socialism based on simplicity and equality morphed into the dreams of the more prosperity-driven members who were would-be budding captains of industry and very interested and invested in exploiting the very bright prospects of creating new wealth and building a model company town on the well-laid foundation of the utopian experiment. I am quite sure that Boover men, listen up, sons. I am quite sure that Boover men found some kind of blessing and perhaps assurance in the factories taking off in the region, for they worked in Milford shoe shops, and perhaps in Hopedale too. My dad, Bernard, a machinist, worked here at the Draper Mills when I was a boy, and so my family drew sustenance from the established industrial base that the early community, in a way, but mostly the Draper brothers, set down. My father is now 86 years old. He recently told me that there are still relatives living in Hopedale, but not living under the Boover name. They are Sears. Do any of you know of any Sears families in Hopedale? I was just hoping they weren't the black sheep of the town. I want to make a special mention of my Catholic worker colleague, Geraldine DiNardo, sitting in the back row. Jerry didn't sit up front, she's out in the back there. She's a backbencher, but she really deserves to be up front at this time too, because despite her most recent declaration to the contrary, Geraldine DiNardo told me that her family once lived in Adin's former residence in Milford. She even showed me the house papers. She says, where are those papers? And I saw them, Jerry, with my own eyes. Jerry lived mostly in Mendon on the shores of Lake Nipmuc. And she, with myself and Frank Kathizer, founded the Mustard Seed Catholic Worker House of Hospitality, now about four decades old, and still going strong as a soup kitchen and as a spiritual community in Worcester. I know that much of what I share about my kinship with Adin, Jerry could likewise share. It is interesting that Jerry and I both came from Blackstone Valley to Worcester to try to do in the 1970s what Adin tried to do here in the 1840s and 50s. Build Christian community. She honors us with her presence here today. Thank you, Geraldine. I also want to let you know that my wife Diane and I, we have long shared an interest in communal studies and have been blessed to visit many of the Shaker communities, Watervliet, New York, New Lebanon, and Hancock in Massachusetts, Enfield in Canterbury in New Hampshire, Sabbath Day Lake in Maine, Pleasant Hill in Kentucky, and also some 19th century counterparts, Fruitlands in nearby Harvard, Zor in Ohio, Oneida in New York, Old Economy in Pennsylvania, as well as many of Benedictine monasteries and Catholic worker communities of today. We have been inspired by so many who held and still hold to a different vision and version of Christianity and America, and we try to keep the banner flying at our place, Annunciation House of Worcester, an urban farm. So it is with great respect for communal forebears, as well as guides today who are practitioners, that we fittingly celebrate this living tradition of sacred communal living, its past, its difficulties, and its promise. You're doing very well, everybody. I admire you. The story of Hopedale is described in Edward K. Spann's book, Hopedale, From Commune to Company Town, 1840 to 1920, may be of great interest, as it describes the many transitions, many of which are still going on, made by the people of Hopedale and the region. Might Spann's book also be viewed as a microcosmic yet highly significant slice of the economic history of the United States? One great need, perhaps, is for folks like the Friends of Adin Ballou to interpret that history in the light of the early vision, if we think that that vision, again, should guide the people of this place. Whether that vision should be clung to or renewed today is probably a good question for us. Turning to that task a bit, we might ask a very simple but essential question. What did Adin Ballou and his followers believe? Well, if you wanted to become a member of the community, you were asked to follow its standards, and very high indeed are they. Here is an excerpt from the Hopedale Community's Covenant, the Standard of Practical Christianity, circa 1841. I believe in the religion of Jesus Christ, as he taught and exemplified it, according to the scriptures of the New Testament. I acknowledge myself a bounden subject of all its moral obligations. Especially do I hold myself bound by all its holy requirements, never under any pretext whatsoever to kill, assault, beat, torture, enslave, rob, oppress, persecute, defraud, corrupt, slander, revile, injure, envy, or hate any human being, even my worst enemy. Never in any manner to violate the dictates of pure chastity. Never to take or administer an oath. Never to manufacture, buy, sell, deal out, or use any intoxicating liquor as a beverage. Never to serve in the army, navy, or militia of any nation, state, or chieftain. Never to bring an action at law, hold office, vote, join a legal posse, petition a legislature, or ask governmental interposition in any case involving a final authorized resort to physical violence. Never to indulge self-will, bigotry, love of preeminence, covetousness, deceit, profanity, idleness, or an unruly tongue. Never to participate in lotteries, games of chance, betting, or pernicious amusements. Never to resent reproof or justify myself in a known wrong. Never to aid, abet, or approve others in anything sinful. But through divine assistance, always to recommend and promote with my entire influence the holiness and happiness of all mankind. Now, I agree with most everything as a Catholic pacifist about not joining the military, and I'm pretty all right with many of the other requirements in general, with a few notable exceptions. I sometimes sign petitions and enjoy Corona Extra. And when I was younger, pure holy chastity was not my strongest suit, although I tried. For these reasons, I'm not sure I would be an acceptable or worthy candidate for fraternal community number one. But in most all others, I think I could give it a fairly good try, even though I confessed I have also likely failed at most of the others too, at least a little bit, if not more. That is why we continually need conversion over and over and over again. I must admit that as a Catholic radical, I have, for better or worse, and sometimes I suspect worse, fallen in with the more Tolstoyan and anarchistic influences within the movement than most. I can easily give up most petition signing without too much damage to good conscience. I've always been more partial to direct action and all truth. I am also, as part Irishman, not unsympathetic to the cause of temperance and stand with the Daughters of Erin, who sought so desperately to get many of their affected men to take the pledge back in the day. Finally, by the forgiveness and grace of God, I have long been happily married to, truth be known, a most loving and patient woman. Boy, what do you think, boys? Should that, does patient work? Does patient? A most loving and patient woman. And with most wild oats formerly sown, I have grown just a little bit more toward the ideal of pure chastity. Is there a possibility I could get into Hopedale after all? What are the chances? Would any of you be as equally intimidated by such a high standard of behavioral goodness? No. Yeah, you're all in. You're all. I suspect most of us would. And yet there is in the holding of high ground by grace, God knows one would need it, the very real things that make for peace. The kind of believing and the kind of work the people of Hopedale community did remains so necessary for the building of the vision of peace, for the giving of flesh to the ideal, to the blessed attempt to actualize the beloved community in the here and now. We are so sorely in need of such belief and labor, now especially as social stresses and damage to the environment threaten us all in many an unprecedented way. Hopedale was born at a time when Ralph Waldo Emerson noted in a letter to Carlyle, his friend across the pond, "Things are a bit wild here. There is not a reading man, sick, alive, who does not have a blueprint for a new society in his waistcoat pocket." Surely Adin Ballou had one in his. The very names of the streets of Hopedale tell the story. Peace Street, Social Street, Chapel Street, Freedom Street, Union Street, High Street, Progress Street, and of course, Adin Street, among others. I sense these holy streets still allude to a certain celestial quality that has long been associated with them, the escaping of what should not be for what should, and that the perception and nature of that quality remains a knowledge most worthy of being explored and had and shared both with the younger generation of inhabitants here and beyond as with us older folks, who need to be reminded and encouraged by the fact that there can be shelter from life lived only in cruel, immoral and terms and social storms. My friends and I today, we have come to these beautiful streets of Hopedale as persons deeply rooted in the Catholic worker tradition, the movement born at the height of the Great Depression, now over 80 years old, still trying to resist war, still serving and comforting the poor in Catholic worker houses in inner cities, and still fomenting a green revolution on Catholic worker farm communes, or agronomic universities, as some like to call them. We come to say that with Adin and Tolstoy, we see that cruelty and war are not effective foils against injustice as they are thought to be. It is an upside down, topsy-turvy world to live in, a world of truly inverted values and beliefs when violence has the sway and the way. In that world, means and ends have no correlation. But we have learned that means and ends do, and that love makes for better prospects, for reconciliation and true community. We question in the tradition of Ballou and Tolstoy how a world such as ours can still make so much positive noise over coercive economic and political maneuvering and use so mindlessly and heartlessly violent force to justify and achieve its unkind ends. We hope and work for a decentralized communitarian rather than competitive economic ethos, and we wish it to take hold in our present culture. I'd like to share a bit of the Catholic Worker vision with you too, so as to let you see just how much we and the Catholic Worker have in common with the practical Christians of Hopedale, 172 years ago, especially in the area of peacemaking. The roundtable will give us a chance to deepen our conversation about those commonalities. Strangely, perhaps, it is radical Catholics who have inherited and or taken up the mantle of Ballou in maintaining principled faith-based pacifism and in starting and sustaining pacifist Christian communes. Of course, we have our kin and many movements of the Reform as well, from Anabaptists and Mennonites to the new monastics made up largely of young Protestant youth living in American ghettos, who intend to instigate profound nonviolent social change from the vantage of faith, such as the Young of the Simple Way in Philadelphia and the young and now not so young of the Sojourners Fellowship in Washington, D.C. We are most grateful for each other. Pacifist Catholics have a difficult task ahead of us, that of living down our church's violent past. Yet we have Francis of Assisi and Dorothy Day to hold up as our most shining exemplars of Christian nonviolence. And shine they do. Interestingly, however, for mysterious as well as observable reasons, perhaps, the Catholic Worker Movement, with its hundreds of albeit modest communities worldwide, seems to both share many of the values of the Hopedale community and as well to have shown some unusual resilience under duress for over 8 decades now. Perhaps it was Hopedale's actual economic success that made it vulnerable to failure or usurpation by businessmen. And it might just be our planned economic modesty, evinced by our commitment to perpetual voluntary poverty, that keeps us protected from any chance of usurpation like that. But we too have our problems, mostly with each other. It is not easy to live together. Upon the 25th anniversary of the mustard seed community, I wrote a little history in which I noted, quote, "Wherever two or three are gathered, even in his name, there is trouble." It's true. But that doesn't mean we should throw in the towel, as they say, but to know, as Dorothy Day, that we need to imbibe faith, hope, and love. Otherwise, you get too discouraged. Here are a few pertinent excerpts culled from the aims and means of the Catholic Worker, and it might be helpful to note how parallel they are in many, if not all, ways to the Hopedale standard. The aim of the Catholic Worker movement is to live in accordance with the justice and charity of Jesus Christ. Our sources are the Hebrew and Greek scriptures as handed down in the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church, with our inspiration coming from the lives of the saints, quote, "men and women outstanding in holiness, living witnesses to your unchanging love," from the Eucharistic prayer. This aim requires us to begin living in a different way. We recall the words of our founders, Dorothy Day, who said, quote, "God meant things to be much easier than we have made them." And Peter Morin, who wanted to build a society, quote, "where it is easier for people to be good." When we examine our society, which is generally called capitalist because of its methods of producing and controlling wealth, and is bourgeois because of prevailing concern for acquisition and material interests, and its emphasis on respectability and mediocrity, we find it far from God's justice. And I'm only going to take one little snippet from the Catholic Worker on nonviolence to kind of connect it to Hopedale. His primary ethos, nonviolence. "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God," Matthew 5:9. Only through nonviolent action can a personless revolution come about, one in which one evil will not be replaced simply by another. Thus, we oppose the deliberate taking of human life for any reason, and we see oppression as blasphemy. Jesus taught us to take suffering upon ourselves rather than inflict it upon others, and he calls us to fight against violence with the spiritual weapons of prayer, fasting, and non-cooperation with evil. Refusal to pay taxes for war, to register for conscription, to comply with any unjust legislation, participation in nonviolent strikes and boycotts, protests or vigils, withdrawal of support for dominant systems, corporate funding, or usurious practices are all excellent means to establish peace. We must be prepared to accept seeming failure with these aims, for sacrifice and suffering are part of the Christian life. Success, as the world determines it, is not the final criterion for judgments. The most important thing is the love of Jesus Christ and how to live his truth. While this statement may seem just a little less intimidating to the modern ear than the standard of the practical Christian, it too is a rather tall order, is it not? And has much in common with the standard. It too is a means to respond to worlds in disarray by the proposal of another way and an adopting of a lived expression as a means to communicate that there is real holy gumption to take it. Assuming a collection of believers have gathered with the purpose of moving away from the polity and tragedy of empire to a life lived with the values of the kingdom of God, justice, love, mercy, healing, light, life, with, quote, new color, new form, as my mentor, Father Bernie Gulgan, used to say. With Jesus, we have another world envisioned, and it is not solely reserved for enjoyment in an afterlife. In him, we have a foot washer, a healer, a giver to emulate here and now, in our time, in our place. We have one who blesses the poor, the meek, the merciful, the mourners, the peacemakers, the longers for righteousness, the persecuted. This is definitely the flip side of empire, and Adin Ballou knew it. We can long with him for something better than empire, both because we have been given hints of the validity of the reign of peace by the teachings of Jesus, but especially by his example, and might I add, the example of his disciple, Adin Ballou. In the Lord's Prayer, we rightfully pray for our daily bread and also for the coming of God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. We also long for this kingdom because we know all too well the reign of violence that is its antithesis, and we want to reject it. Otherwise, we would not need to refer to the reign of heaven at all as something to desire. So Adin Ballou, with these theological bearings and longings, both came to this lovely valley to establish a city of peace, but also to form a community with a heart for the poor, who came here too. He had what we call in our day solidarity, even as he also had a sense of providing a haven, a refuge, a heaven for those trying to get out of the hells that folks struggled to leave behind in his day, those of inebriation, inequality, servitude, war. Hopedalians then sheltered drunks on the men, women seeking equality with men, lived out perhaps most visually in the new, more fitting and comfortable and controversial clothing line, bloomers, of Hopedale's women. Escaped slaves and their advocates, white friends of black folk in trouble with the law, Christians who were okay with the praising of the Lord, but not okay with the passing of the ammunition, beard wearers, vegetable eaters, water curers, spiritualists, and the community-minded of many stripes and persuasions. Sojourner Truth spoke here, and William Lloyd Garrison and Frederick Douglass, Robert Owen visited, all kinds of reformers and would-be reformers received hospitality here. There was a great generosity extended to interested and interesting visitors. A boarding school that taught the values of the peaceable community, as well as the classic subjects of the day, shaped a generation of enlightened and happy youth. Imagine such a thing. You can, can't you?
Yeah.
The Hopedalians were upholding the notion by their lifestyle that we can indeed gracefully arrive at the provision of some modicum of justice, love, and respect for each other that can both define and characterize the kinds of relation we would prefer to have with each other and with creation. Right relation, as the Buddhists would say, relation that truly gives us hope. As you may know, Peter Morin, the French peasant scholar and co-founder with Dorothy Day of the Catholic Worker Movement, stated, "We need a society where it's easier for people to be good." But he also taught us to begin with ourselves, which is what Adin also taught. This is the way to stop worshiping mammon and start worshiping the true God, who St. John says is love and whom we should abide. How? By becoming loving people ourselves. It is hard to do, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But We have directions. Peter taught in his easy essay, The Case for Utopia, this. The world would be better off if people tried to become better. And people would become better if they stopped trying to become better off. For when everybody tries to become better off, nobody is better off. But when everybody tries to become better, everybody is better off. Everybody would be rich if nobody tried to become richer. And nobody would be poor if everybody tried to be the poorest. And everybody would be what he or she ought to be if everybody tried to be what they want the other person to be. Easy to recite, not so easy to live. This is surely what Adin Ballou had in mind when he first entertained the notion of starting such a community in Hopedale, building a society where it would be easier to be good and the world could see, emulate, and multiply. A society where people try to be better rather than better off. For this vision of the human project, Adin Ballou and his fellows had hope, and that is what we need too. Hope. Hope for laying once more the foundations of a community at once more just, more loving, and more respectful toward each individual. We have come here from many directions to celebrate and entertain that hope anew. It is a good season to do so, as we seem to be in a time when brighter visions of a blessed future paradigmatically collide with very dark assessments, not only of predicted dystopias and decaying empires, but of present gross inequality, massive government surveillance, and perpetual war. Competing visions of blessedness and horror haunt our dreams and consciences. But today, I would urge us to stay on the sunny side of the street, in praise of and prizing what is good. I would urge this largely because we need so badly to cheer up. And because it is, as the Victorian romantic John Ruskin, who coined the phrase, and as Dorothy Day, the co-founder of the Catholic Worker Movement, so oft repeated in attempts to cheer herself up, it is the duty of delight that will likely produce a far better result for us, who would, like the Hopedalians of old, see a better day. But admittedly, it is often a struggle. To stay on the sunny side is also an act of faith and hope, isn't it? In love. It does have its consolations. Emily Dickinson, another of the great 19th century luminaries, declared her own poetic allegiance to hope with the lines, I dwell in possibility, a fairer house than prose, more numerous for windows, superior for doors. I like her attitude. It is helpful, faithful in an honest way. But certainly we must also reckon with the sad truth that today, poor people, people of color, and people of conscience and vision are often facing formidable and callous contrary winds. We need the vision of Hopedale to be renewed and tried again in a new way. The Hopedalians wanted to live in peace, and to a large extent their intention was blessed, even if sorely tested. The founders of Hopedale have given the world a gift, despite the challenges that remained insurmounted and their own shortcomings at the time. They gave us a glimpse of what Christianity looks like when practiced. It is my hope that we could more deeply appreciate, appropriate, and then extend that gift to our children today. But I also suggest that we go about this ongoing work very humbly and carefully in the light of the lessons learned by the Hopedalians in their surely to be regretted and deeply lamented loss of their struggling but morally superior socialist vision to that of a capitalist model. After their nearly 15 years of exhaustive work building the village, Hopedale was interested in sating spiritual and physical hungers, in easing and calming that restlessness that leads to increased conflict and war. The blessed rootedness of this village, born in a holy vision of peace, has much to teach us about the future, about the need to still be carving out now a place of justice and goodness in the moral universe, to be traversing the wildernesses and economic jungles of our time for a place where the common good is thought of, planned, and pursued in the daily round. We would do well to consider over and over again the values taught and continually stemming from the root of the Hopedale experiment. There is so much light, moral vision, and gentle persuasive power to be had in tapping into that root. If there were such a thing as a time machine, wouldn't it be interesting to travel in it and visit with the early communards who were so daring and hopeful in undertaking this noble experiment at all? Their dream of setting down a Christian republic, honoring the dignity of all, renouncing the use of physical or legal force for settling disputes, and the building of an economy that served people rather than the other way around, remains not only a shining vision, but a most needed corrective to the abuse, manipulation, violence, and economic inequality that so characterize our own time and that threatens our collective future. But that vision was put to the test and suffered, and there are lessons for us to learn in that too. There are many themes and topics that might be taken up in the light of Hopedale's history, and I suspect in these annual lectures, many of them have already been taken up and will continue to be taken up. We all likely have a unique story of our own with regard to connectedness to Hopedale. These are certainly worth our visiting and revisiting. If we do this, here you go, Hopedale folks, if we do this, the Hopedale Homeschool will certainly be back in session. It can happen. The great gift of Hopedale, as I see it, is that people really tried to live their faith, discontented to simply profess it with their lips. This, my friends, I suggest, was and remains no small achievement. They put their hearts, heads, and hands to work to the task of giving Live Christianity a try. Susan Thwing, one former community member and later brilliant commentator, put so admiringly a good word in for Hopedale's vision, even in the wake of the community's struggles and some might say failure. She wrote, "Surely they hitched their wagon to a star, and though it fell to earth, it left a pathway so bright that it still points the way to perfection." The Hopedalians learned, I think, that genuine community is a gift as well as a human work. It can't always be scripted. But it seems they also learned that being open to the gift and cooperating with faithful others in the work keeps begging us to refine a sense of things that is ever evolving. We are asked to attend to the multiple and myriad and sometimes seemingly paradoxical emphases that entertaining visionary impulses entails. How can we better welcome visionary light into our own circumstances and let that light guide us in making the changes we want to make and need to make? I suggest that it is Gaudi who taught us well in this regard. Be the change you want to see in the world. But we needn't do it all alone or do it with all too deadly seriousness. Oh, yeah. More jokes. I need more jokes. One who looked at his own time with a critical eye. We're almost there, gang, almost there. Who looked with a critical eye, but also from the vantage of faith from his monastic hermitage in the back hills of Kentucky in the 20th century was Thomas Merton, someone I'm very fond of. The wise Trappist monk and spiritual writer takes good stock of an essential truth, the recognition of which can help us better greet each new morning. He said, he wrote, "The great thing, after all, is to live." Mm-hmm. I like that too, living that is, especially as today just happens to also be my 62nd birthday, and there is no better birthday present or privilege for me personally this day than to have been here speaking to you about Adin Ballou and those who joined him in founding this village of Hopedale on this basis of practical Christianity. Or better, as I have personally found Christianity sometimes not best defined or described by the word practical, founded on practiced Christianity. I find the witness of the Hopedalians to be altogether very life-giving. Still sounding that note of hope in an echo to us in the 21st century. In fact, Adin said his message came too soon for his own generation. When his first generation failed to fulfill the mission as he saw it, he was gracious, even in the depths of disappointment, not to play the blame game so much as to note they were not prepared. Adin Ballou thought that the failure was inevitable because the community, in his words, quote, lacked the wisdom, the grace, the large-mindedness, the generosity, the nobility of soul, in a single word, the Christ-likeness that was requisite to the end we sought. It was to us that he looked when at the end of his life he reviewed his mission. Looking over his spiritual shoulder, so to speak, he wrote, I have not been a man of much popular success, but in several respects of failure. Not because my intentions, principles, ideas, objects, and plans were reprehensible and unworthy of success, but because they foreran the conditions and means indispensable to its acquisition. My hopes were too urgent and sanguine. My standard and aim were set too high for immediate realization. I wouldn't argue with that point. So have I been defeated, and some of my noblest schemes, some of my most disinterested and earnest labors have been expended in vain. And my way has been overshadowed with disappointment and grief. The world has judged and will for some time longer judge of me and of my undertakings after its own ancient fashion, and I complain not. In the wisdom of God, all is for the best, and nothing true or good is forever lost. The final verdict is not rendered yet, and my case and cause are adjourned to a more auspicious future. Times and generations are coming that will justly estimate me and my work and assign both their proper place in the providential plan for the progress and redemption of humanity. For them, as it has proved, have I lived and labored, rather than for my contemporaries. To them I appeal for vindication and approval. To them I bequeath whatever is valuable and worth preserving of my possessions, the fruits of my toil, while yet a dweller in the tabernacles of earth and time. It is to us today that Adin has pitched his noble and holy message. As Adin said, nothing true or good is forever lost. It surely ain't. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.